When it comes to political correctness, World Wrestling Entertainment has missed the mark on several occasions. It seems that Vince McMahon doesn't understand where the line is drawn sometimes, or even it seems that Vince McMahon likes to cross the line to see what kind of reaction he can get. In the year 2020, pettiness mixed with a lack of care and insensitivity is really enough these days for your business to get cancelled, for better or for worse. And that line that Vince McMahon likes to cross, well, I'd like to say that he knows to stay well behind it nowadays. In the 80s and 90s though, and even up to the 2000s, there was absolutely nothing Vince McMahon wouldn't put on TV. If an idea seemed funny in Vince's mind, or if he really thought something could work, he put it on his television shows. It didn't just stop at outlandish and insensitive ideas though. Vince McMahon had no issue at all getting jabs into his enemies via the characters he created for TV or storylines that unfolded in the ring. IRS, for example, was created due to Vince McMahon's disdain for the Taxman, who was knocking on WWF's doors. Hunter Hearst Helmsley was created as Vince McMahon felt that his neighbours acted in a snobbish manner. The Right to Censor was a parody of the Parents Television Council, a group who were coming down hard on the WWF and its advertisers at the time. There are so many examples of Vince McMahon using his platform to share his own personal beliefs or thoughts. In Vince McMahon's mind, putting these characters on TV screens was a roundabout way of getting some sort of revenge, as ridiculous as it sounds. Enter Akeem the African Dream, a Vince McMahon creation that was both insensitive and a vehicle for revenge, and the whole thing was also so ridiculous that it was hilarious. Hilariously bad, you may say, but it's one of those things where you just shake your head in disbelief as you watch this train wreck take place before your very eyes. George Gray was a Caucasian male, standing in at 6'9" and weighing 450 pounds, and he worked as the one-man gang previously, a bad-to-the-bone biker dude who steamrolled through his opponents. In September of 1988, his character was changed from the one-man gang to Akeem, the African Dream. George Gray had, apparently, found his roots in the deepest, darkest Africa, and he now spoke in an extremely stereotypical black accent, and he danced. Boy, did he dance. Dusty Rhodes had become Vince McMahon's arch rival during a time when Dusty was booking for the NWA, and the African Dream was supposedly an indirect shot at Dusty, the American Dream, along with Dusty's mannerisms both inside and outside the ring. Before the pitchforks come out, or before you share what's on your mind regarding Akeem and the whole basis for the character, I have to remind you that back then, audiences didn't really give a shit. As much as you may not like it, or as much as maybe you did like it, I'm not here to tell you what to think or what to feel about the character, but I will say the crowds back then understood that this was a dumb character and they were content enough to go along with it. Don't get me wrong, I don't think this was one of Vince McMahon's greatest ideas, and a past time of society doesn't excuse how ludicrous the whole thing was, but your average Joe wrestling fan of the mid-80s laughed at the character and thought nothing more of it. Akeem though would never, ever, ever, ever work in today's social and political climate, not a chance. The only other character I think I can compare Akeem to in more modern times would be Chavo Guerrero when he played Kerwin White, but that's for another time. Just to get this out of the way also, George has said that he never felt the Akeem character was a shot at Dusty Rhodes at all, and if it was supposed to be a shot at Dusty, then George was never told about it. Dusty would make his way to the WWF just under a year after the Akeem character made its debut, and as we all know, Dusty was put in the polka dot outfit, which still, people say to this day, was not a rib on Dusty. So anyway, let's briefly take a look at the one-man gang first. just so we can try to gain an understanding of how ridiculous this all was. George was born on February 12, 1960 in South Carolina, and he began his wrestling career at the age of 17. From 1977 to 1982, Gray worked for a slew of promotions including International Championship Wrestling and Mid-South. In 1985, he stopped off at the Dallas Sportatorium to work for World Class Championship Wrestling for a year, having matches with the likes of Chris Adams, Bruiser Brody and Kerry Von Erich. His matches in World Class show just how much of a rough and tough badass he was. The one-man gang here took no prisoners with some hard-hitting matches that you can actually watch right now on the WWE Network. It wasn't World Class though where Gray made a name for himself, but instead it was in Mid-South. One Man Gang became a main event player in the territory, feuding with fan favourite Jim Duggan when the promotion renamed itself to the Universal Wrestling Federation. He even became the UWF Heavyweight Champion and held the title for around 6 months. Gray didn't go looking for work with the World Wrestling Federation, but it was the WWF who called him in 1987 and asked if he would be willing to sign a contract. The guy was quite sought after. I'd also like to briefly point out here that during my research into the Akeem character, I ran across numerous interviews featuring George Gray talking about when he signed for the WWF and things like that, and something that really stands out and something that I think I should say is just how polite and generally nice the guy comes across as. He comes across as a really good and humble dude in his interviews. Do check them out. Anyway, in the beginning, the one-man gang was booked extremely strong in the WWF against enhancement guys. With the smooth-talking Slick in his corner, one-man gang would steamroll through the opposition, match after match, as would many new heels in the WWF in hopes of setting up a new villain against the WWF superheroes such as Hulk Hogan and Randy Savage. Although the one-man gang was very successful against lower card opponents, he would frequently lose to the WWF's bigger stars, but hey, who didn't back then? One-man gang was booked into the very first Survivor Series pay-per-view where he was a member of Andre the Giant's team, facing a team led by the immortal Hulk Hogan, and in the very first Royal Rumble in 1988, he was the last man thrown over the top rope. At WrestleMania 4, One Man Gang entered the WWF Championship Tournament and made it to the semi-finals, however he was disqualified in his semi-final match against eventual tournament winner Macho Man Randy Savage. After WrestleMania 4, the OMG was placed lower on the cards. Sometime between WrestleMania 4 and September of 1988 is when Vince McMahon decided that the One Man Gang, this huge intimidating biker who had displayed the ability to totally wreck opponents, would become African American and rename himself Akeem. George Gray himself said, "Vince came over to me and casually asked me, do I know how to dance? I thought he was joking around. I said, no, I don't know, I'm not a good dancer. He goes, well, you need to learn, and he walked off. I didn't understand it. I called Slick over and asked Slick, what's going on? He asked if I know how to dance or something. He goes, oh man, we got this great idea that I went to Africa and I found your roots, and we're going to turn you into a black man and you're going to be a king. You know, the African dream and all that. You're going to be dancing and talking jive with me and everything. I thought he was just ribbing me. I thought it was a big joke. Sure enough, 3 weeks later, they were calling me up to get fitted for the Akeem outfit, and it went on from there." Vince told George that the One Man Gang character had become dull and boring. There was nothing to market there and he wanted this new colourful and dancing character in the hopes that it would generate more interest. George, in his mind, felt he had to get the Akeem character over. This was his last chance in the World Wrestling Federation, and if he didn't go over the top with it, he could end up unemployed. To introduce Akeem to audiences at home, the WWF sent Gene Okerlund out to the streets on the September 27th, 1988 edition of Primetime Wrestling to search for Slick. Gene said that Slick had promised to bring him to the deepest and darkest parts of Africa, but Slick said he was going to bring Africa to us instead. Slick said he had an announcement that will shake the very foundations of wrestling. He has a new superstar who has transformed after finding his roots. Tribal dancers were introduced as Mean Gene looked on in disbelief, saying he is about to call his lawyers, that he has now been reborn and he has now found his roots while speaking in a stereotypical jive African-American accent. He danced off screen with Slick as Mean Gene ran away in fear of the tribal African dancers. Naturally, the vignette drew a lot of criticism. When we went back to the primetime studio, Gorilla Monsoon said that in all his years in the wrestling business, he had never seen anything like this before. George said in an interview, "Everybody there was a big, giant character. We were all just big cartoons, and that's what Vince wanted, big cartoons. Nowadays, you couldn't get away with it. You've got this black manager and he's going to take a white man and show him his roots to turn him black. Nowadays, people would probably protest. I had to do what I had to do. Luckily, it got over." The first match we have for Akeem was against Scott Hudson on an October episode of WWF Superstars. The whole match is available on YouTube. It only has around 570 views at the time this video was scripted, and it has one single comment from a guy proclaiming that the African Dream is his favourite black wrestler. It's a quick squash match here. Akeem spends more time moonwalking and dancing than actually wrestling, which is still quite amusing to watch. Also, check out some of Akeem's backstage interviews after watching this match. You will notice that the guy has a real hard time staying still while his arms seemingly twitch and rotate around. George Gray said that Vince McMahon asked him to learn how to dance, and to be fair, I don't think he went to any classes, but anyway, this just added to the character. Akeem would then have a string of victories on the road to the Survivor Series in 1988, and at this show, he and the Big Boss Man captained a team to take on the Mega Powers team, featuring Randy Savage, Hulk Hogan, Hercules, Hillbilly Jim, and Coco Beware. Akeem and the Boss Man's team were defeated, but at least he was back in some sort of main event position within the WWF. Akeem would then continue defeating lesser talents at house shows, and the odd TV show victory also came, but when it came to matches with the big stars like Hogan, Akeem could never get a win. The Big Boss Man and Akeem formed the Twin Towers tag team, which got launched right into the main event. The Twin Towers feuded with the Mega Powers, and while the Twin Towers were merely being used here as a way to progress an upcoming feud between Savage and Hogan, the Boss Man and Akeem were getting a lot of television exposure here. The Twin Towers never did win the tag titles, but they were featured in high profile feuds, which really is all you can ask for if you're not booked to win any gold. Eventually, just like Hogan and Savage, Akeem and the Boss Man also broke up and had a match at WrestleMania 6, a match that the Boss Man won, and thus Akeem's days in the spotlight were over. WrestleMania 6 was really Akeem's final big match on television as he got shuffled to the lower mid card. But I know you guys aren't here for the rundown on Akeem matches week by week or month by month. It's the character that draws attention, and I totally get that. Apparently, Vince McMahon loved the Akeem character once he saw it on TV. George Gray knew also that if he turned down the gimmick, he would have been eventually fired from the company, so he felt he had no choice but to go along with it. Gray said that he grew to enjoy the character and he had fun with the dancing and stuff, but he also admitted that he struggles to go back and watch it today, thanks to the waves of cringe that overcome his very being when he sees Akeem the African Dream. There is absolutely no denying here that the Akeem character had a lot of racial overtones and stereotypes to it, and in today's publicly owned World Wrestling Entertainment, this wouldn't be allowed. With this in mind, somehow George still managed to make the character memorable. I'd say that fans remember George Gray as Akeem when compared to George Gray as the one-man gang. And this is the kind of thing that feeds into the comedy wrestling versus traditional wrestling argument that is never-ending and, dare I say, fucking boring on social media. The problem arises though when the comedy character is portraying a stereotype. That's when it gets a little questionable. Akeem was entertaining in an absurd way that the whole roots in Africa thing just wasn't needed. He could still go out there, dance around, be silly and entertaining without the nonsense backstory. It's clear though that George was simply doing what he was told. He was afraid of losing his job and he went along with whatever Vince McMahon had going on in his head at the time. History has showed us that this wasn't the last time Vince McMahon would cross lines either. The man feels like he is invincible and in a weird kind of way, he has gotten away with it every single time. Because of how goofy and downright ridiculous the Akeem character was though, it isn't brought up as much as other examples. In a weird kind of way, Akeem gets sort of a bye ball because people got a kick out of the dancing and overall silliness of his mannerisms. This doesn't excuse the character at all, but George Gray is such a nice guy in interviews and radio shows that I'm kinda glad that he himself doesn't take any heat for the Akeem character and instead, we all know that it was Vince McMahon's doing. If there's any lesson here, it's that Vince McMahon would put anything on TV, there were no limits. We will come back to George Gray in a later video to take a proper look at his run as the one-man gang, a character that kicked a lot of ass before making his way to the WWF, and a character that also made a comeback after Akeem. George would find his way to WCW in 1991 and again in 1995 as the one-man gang, but we will look into this another time.